gospel, Lord. We've been focusing on evangelism and the need for evangelism. And what we are talking about right now is, it would help if I get on the right page. Evangelistic eyesight. Our need to have a burden and a passion for souls. And even though we've been focusing on that, it all begins in one location with each and one, every one of us. If we are going to see souls saved, it begins with you, it begins with me. Why do some churches die off? Because they, right before I like to preach nursing home, I joke around with Brother Peterman that sometimes that I'm going to use the main text of why sit ye here till ye die. But the truth of the matter is, that's exactly what some churches do. They get to an older generation, and then as they slowly die off, if there's no youth to carry on, the church is going to die. Beyond that, we have the Great Commission. Jesus Christ said, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel. It's not a matter of whether or not you want to win souls right now. It's a command. There are things we do in life because we know that we're supposed to do, and we do it. For example, I go to work not because I think it's fun, but I have a guy named Bill show up every month with his friends. Electric bill, mortgage bill, credit card bill. I might not always want to go to work, to be honest. That's probably 99.9% of the time, if not all the time. But the truth of the matter is, I go. Why do I go? Because I have to go. It's something that I know is required of me. If I don't, what's going to be the repercussions? No electricity, no water. Now, let's be honest, this time of the year, I like my heat. But there comes a point with the Great Commission and personal evangelism that it comes to past the point of Jesus said, go, and I know I have to go, to a point where we begin taking it earnestly. We take verses like, he that winneth souls is wise to heart. And we actually purpose in our heart, in prayer, to try to win souls. We purpose in prayer to get the heart of God. And we've said time and time again that God's desire on this earth was, the reason he came was not to give us gifts. We do have plenty of gifts. We have the fruits of the Spirit, we have prophets, we have evangelists, we have preachers, we have teachers, we have tongues, interpretation, prophecy, word of wisdom, word of knowledge. We have the unction of the Spirit. We have out of our belly shall flow living waters, rivers of living water. Ye shall lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. But the Son of God did not come to earth to do that. He came to seek and to save that which is lost, Brother Eli. He didn't come to give us gifts per se. They are a byproduct. They were extra. But the main reason that Jesus Christ came to this earth was to seek and to save that which is lost. Time and time again, as we look through Scripture, whether it be the Old Testament, whether it be the New Testament, if we would truly see the heart of God, we would realize that his burden was for the lost. Jesus Christ went and he wept over Jerusalem. How many times in the Old Testament did God cry out to the Jews, if only you would seek my face, if only you would have done what was right. I have sought after you, what more can I do? I've sent you the prophets, and we hear the prophets crying out to the Jews to come back to repentance. We have the book of Hosea, which is God's love letter to the Jews. It shows us his heart, how he longed for them. God's heartbeat is the law. And there needs to come a point where it comes past that we realize that it's a command and we do it too. It's a burden. It's something that drives us. We have to win souls. John Prang Hai was a missionary to India. And his prayer was, God, give me one soul. Just give me one soul today. Then God began giving him one soul. Then his cry began, God, give me two souls. And it went on and on. He had a burden and a passion for souls. We talked about John Knox for his famous prayer, give me Scotland or I die. These are men that didn't just have a command that they followed, but it became part of their being. It became a burden. It became a passion. They gained evangelistic eyesight, and it only became clear, and they only developed that burden in a place of prayer. We talked about last week that we need to realize that it is our responsibility to win the lost. Because the truth of the matter is, not only is it just a command, but if we don't do it, who will? There are a lot of people in this world that's perfectly content going, sitting through church, doing their normal Sunday routine, listening to their sermon. They've done good. Maybe they haven't fallen asleep when you brought Pastor Savelle. They made it through the service. They've done their Sunday good deed. I've heard preachers even saying that they don't care what you do during the week as long as you come and repent on Sunday. That is not Christianity. Christianity is a transformation process into the image of the Son of God. And if we are truly being transformed into the image of God, then we will eventually develop the heart of God, or at least pieces of it. And part of that is, and a strong big part of God's heart is to reach the lost at any cost. It is our responsibility. We talked about Lester Sumrall and made mention of his account with the Filipino girl. There was a Filipino girl, and she made the headlines years and years ago about her wildish behavior. Lester Sumrall, being a preacher in Indiana, realized that it was demon possession. This is his most famous account. And he prayed and prayed that God would send somebody to deliver her. And guess what God said? Tell so-and-so to go. I'll send so-and-so. No, he said, if you go, I will deliver her. You know, it's easy to pray for something and have God say, well, I'm going to send somebody, but it's even harder when God says, you go. Well, guess what? When it comes to personal evangelism, that is exactly what he said. He didn't say wait for so-and-so. He didn't say wait until you have the Bible perfectly memorized. He said, go. Go ye into all the world, preach the gospel to every creature. It is our responsibility, whether we like it or not. And then we talk about recognizing man's sinful condition. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. No, not just one, but all of them. You and me, and it is an inherited condition through Adam, because Adam sinned, all have sinned. And the truth of the matter is, if you've sinned, where are you going to spend eternity? It's going to be in hell. And this world, and the devil's gotten good at manipulation. He's been around for a long time. And he's convinced some people that this life on earth is going to be the realest hell you'll ever experience. When that, in reality, that's not true. Hell is awaiting for anyone who has not accepted Jesus Christ as a personal Savior and has been living a Christian life, have been living according to the Bible. And this is where we left off last week, where all sinners will spend eternity in the lake of fire. And someone would please read Revelation chapter 2, verse 11. Revelation 2, verse 11. And someone else, Revelation 20 and verse 14. Revelation 20 and verse 14. And we're going to be reading a bunch of passages here. Could you read that one more time, please, brother?
He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. He that overcometh shall not be hurt of the second death.
He shall not be hurt of the second death. What about Revelation 20 and verse 14? Revelation 20 and verse 14.
And death and hell were taken to the lake of fire.
This is the second death, being cast into the lake of fire. And what about one more? It's just one chapter over, Revelation chapter 21 and verse 8.
But the fearful and the unbelieving and the abominable and the murderers and the whoremongers and second death.
So it's not just death and hell being cast into the lake of fire, but all sinners. And we go, and once again, he has what I call a sin list in there, where the writer actually goes through and lists a bunch of sins. And we've seen Paul do that in the book of Galatians as well. But they shall have a part in the lake of fire. It's not going to be heaven, but anyone who is a sinner will have their part in the lake of fire. And when we look at the lake of fire, it is not a fun place. It is not a place you want to go. It doesn't matter who's there. People may say that, well, I want to go to hell because that's where all my friends are, so we're going to have a fun time. It's not going to be a fun time. In fact, it's going to be the farthest thing from it. And it's so probably unfathomable that William General Booth, I got that backwards, General William Booth, the foundation of the Salvation Army, said if he could, as a final training of all his soldiers, he'd hang them over hell for 24 hours just so they could get a sense of what hell is like, so they would know what they're fighting against. It is such a grievous place. It is a place of eternal torment. We find that in Luke chapter 16 and 24, which I will read. Luke 16, 24. If someone would please get Revelation 19, 20 and hold that. Revelation 19, 20. Someone else, 2 Thessalonians 1, 9. 2 Thessalonians 1, 9. And hold that. But hell is a place of eternal torment. We heard the other week Bill Weiss's testimony of how when God took him to hell and gave him that experience, that was something so horrible, so hopeless, that there was no end to it. It was unfathomable. In Luke chapter 16, verse 24, the Bible reads, "And he cried and said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me, and send Lazarus that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in this flame." If we would think about the rich man here, son of this flame, he's begging Abraham to send Lazarus because he is stuck in a flame. It is a place of hopelessness. Obviously, he's begging Abraham to send somebody in his place because there's no way out for him. He cannot find a way out of that flame. He's eternally tormented in that flame. And he's going through such agony that he's begging somebody to go and tell my brothers, tell my family members that they do not want to come to this place. It is that horrible. If I could get to them, Brother Peterman, I would send somebody, but I am hopeless. It's like I'm stuck here, whether it be super glue, chain. There is no hope that I can get out. I am stuck. It is a place of eternal torment. How about Revelation chapter 19 and 20? What does Revelation 19 and 20 state? It states that it's burning with brimstone. There's a foul odor there. It's like sulfuric. Once again, just going back to Bill Weiss's testimony, he said that the smell down there was so horrible, it was like if it could kill you over several times. And I realize that's one man's testimony versus the Word of God. But it is a place of burning brimstone. What about 2 Thessalonians 1:9? It's an everlasting destruction. We can look at horrible weather phenomenon. We can look at tornadoes. We can look at hurricanes. See the path they leave behind, the destruction involved. Can you imagine the destruction that is done to the human body in hell? But it's everlasting. It's ongoing. It's not like it's shredded once and that's it. It's everlasting, it's ongoing, and it's something that's going to last forever. For the rich man that was stuck in that flame, he is stuck there forever. There is no hope of escape. There is no hope that tomorrow might be a better day. He is stuck there in torment for the rest of eternity, where life is but a vapor. He is in it for the long haul, and there is no escape. We find that is a place of never-ending fire. In Jude chapter 1, verse 7, Jude 1, 7, if you have Jude chapter 2, you obviously have the wrong Bible. In Jude chapter 1 and verse 7, the Bible states, even as Sodom and Gomorrah and the cities about them in like manner, giving themselves over to fornication and going after strange flesh, and set forth an example, suffering the vengeance of eternal fire. If you go back and reread the book of Genesis, and reread the account of Abraham, it describes Sodom and Gomorrah before the judgment. The Bible states that the land of Sodom and Gomorrah was lush. It was plenteous. It was green. It was fertile. It was a nice place to dwell in. Now you can plant your crops, you can settle down, but after the destruction, it was a wasteland. When we look at hell, it is a place of never-ending fire. Jude compared it to Sodom and Gomorrah after she was judged. It is a barren wasteland. There is nothing that can grow there. It's fruitless. The only thing that grows there is hatred and judgment and punishment. Hell is a place that you do not want to find yourself. And it's not a place that we want to find anyone else there. But if we are going to get evangelistic eyesight, if we are going to get a burden and a passion for the lost, we need to get a realization that hell is a real place. And it is horrible. It is a place that is full of destruction, hopelessness. It stinks. The fire is never quenched. And then when it comes to the individuals down there, their memory is going to be perfectly intact. Would someone please read Mark chapter 9, verse 44. Mark 9, 4, 44. If someone else would get Matthew 8, 12 and hold that, Matthew 8, 12. And someone else, Luke 13 and 28 and hold that.
Where the worm dieth not, and the fire is not quenched.
Where the worm dieth not, and the fire is not quenched. When we look at this passage and study it out, it's referring to their memory. Their memory not going to die out. They're going to remember everything. Can you imagine sitting in hell for eternity, being punished and tormented, and remembering every opportunity that you had to come to Christ, but you rejected it? Maybe can you remember sitting through every sermon, and maybe somehow you see yourself sitting in the pew, maybe scoffing the preacher, or just sitting there in stubbornness, and almost sitting from a third party view, watching and just yelling at yourself, go to the altar, you dummy. Go and get it right then and there. If only I would have got it right. If only I would have jumped at it. Can you imagine maybe sitting there and seeing yourself, listening to the whole sermon over and over again, and just wishing that something different would happen, that you would go running down the altar. Maybe you'd be screaming at yourself to go ahead and do it, like people do at sports when they get angry or frustrated. Can you imagine remembering every opportunity that you had to get right with God? Can you imagine remembering every opportunity that came your way to accept Jesus Christ as your personal Savior? And maybe, just maybe, God sends an angel by in your lifetime, and that image pops up, and you realize that it's an angel from God coming to witness at your door, or coming to witness to you in a public place. That God went out of his way to try to bring you into the fold, but you rejected it. Hell is a place where you will remember everything. And who's to say that our senses and everything will not seem more real in eternity than it will, than things do right now? That our senses will be more awakened then than they are right now. What about Matthew 8:12?
But the children of the kingdom shall be cast out into the outer darkness. They shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth.
It is a place of outer darkness where there is weeping and gnashing of teeth. Did I say Luke 13:28 as well? Go ahead and read Luke 13:28. There will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. They will be in such pain and agony, they'll be crying out. They'll be in such pain and agony that they're grinding their teeth together for comfort or for relief. But there will be none. Hell is a real place. Possibly more real than life here on this earth. And while James compared this life to a vapor, there is no end to eternity. It just goes on and on and on. And it's within this vapor, within this puff of smoke, that we are to make our decision whether we are going to enter into heaven and spend eternity with God, or are we going to spend eternity with Him. Every individual has this opportunity, has this decision to make. And while we can sit through church and say, well, I'm saved, I'm going to heaven, I know I'm right, we can rejoice over the preaching and songs concerning the rapture and Christ coming back at any moment, we can sing, oh, how I want to see Him and look upon His face. But the reality is, while we rejoice in the fact that we're going to heaven, there are a lot more souls dying and going to hell. Every second, two individuals have made their decision, they're going to either heaven or hell, and the majority of them are going to hell. Because narrow is the way that leads to life, but broad is the way that leads to destruction. There are a lot more people entering into hell than there are heaven. And guess whose responsibility it is to take the message to them? It is our responsibility. And it has to get past the point where we realize that it's a command and it's our responsibility, that it becomes a burden and a passion. Because when it comes a burden and a passion, it will drive us. It will push us. You know, there can be such a burden in our life that I have to tell this individual about Christ and make sure they're right. Because heaven or hell weighs in the balance. And I need to make sure that their decisions have set them on the right path. Hell is too severe a place for anyone to go. It wasn't designed for us. It was designed for the devil and his angels. But yet, because of rebellion, because of stubbornness, because of self-will, people make their own decision to enter into hell. It's not that no one knows about right and wrong. We all know about right and wrong from little or not. And we're not going to get into is the heathen really lost conversation here. But it is our responsibility to present the gospel message to people to show them how to accept Jesus Christ as a personal Savior, to lead them to Christ before it's too late. When it comes to hell, there is no escape. Ever. When you're there, you're there. You made your decision. There is no going back. There is no reset button. Video games today, they have a reset button. I remember growing up that we used to complain when mom would say when lunch is ready or something because we were playing a video game and you couldn't reset it if you, quote unquote, died at that point. And Mario, you had to pause it, but if you paused too long, the Nintendo might have went haywire. You know, there was no reset button. When it was over, it was over. In this life, when it's over, it's over. There is no reset button. There is no pause button at the last moment. When God says that's your last breath, that is your last breath. And hell is forever. When you end up there, you are stuck there forever. And it is so severe that Christ spoke more about hell than he did about heaven. He described hell more than he described heaven. And as much as we long for heaven, Christ longed and yearned that people would not go to hell. The whole reason he came was to seek and save that which was lost, to prevent them from going to hell. When we look at hell, we've already said that it wasn't designed for man, it was designed for the devil and his angels. And we find that in Jude chapter 1, verse 6, and 2 Peter 2 and 4, that there are angels kept down there in reserve waiting for their final judgment. They're kept in chains. But yet the reality is, if we do not accept Jesus Christ as our personal Savior, we will end up in hell with those chained demons. We need to get a burden for the lost. Would someone please read Luke chapter 19 and verse 10, Luke 19, 10, and also verse 41 through 44. Luke 19, 10, verses 41 and 44 as well. Jesus Christ came to seek and save that which is lost, including the Jews, and they rejected him. And he went out and he wept over the city. He longed for them. He desired them. How much more do we long and desire after souls? Do we weep after souls? If we don't become burdened for souls, who will? And this is one of those harder parts of Christianity. It's easy to come to church and say, "Pastor, if you need the bathroom clean, I can do that. No big deal." It's something physical. It's easy to do something physical over something spiritual. It's easy to do something within our comfort zone versus step outside of our comfort zone. Because guess what? If we're going to lead people to Christ or tell them about him, we got to talk to people we don't know. And that's outside of our comfort zone. We got to show them scriptures. And then we get a little panicky. Well, what if I don't remember the verse? What if I don't remember the passage? What if I don't remember the quote? No. If we don't become burdened for souls, the fact of the matter still rests, who will? It's our responsibility. We must get a vision of hell and realize that it is a real place where real people go when they die. Jude chapter 1, the only chapter in Jude, verse 23 states, and we're going to go back to verse 22. And of some having compassion, making a difference, and others save with fear, pulling them out of the fire, hating even garments spotted by the flesh. These individuals went out seeking souls that they may snatch them from the flames of hell before it's too late. And they did it with such compassion and earnestly, and I'm probably not even saying a real word, but the Bible describes it as they did it with fear. What does that tell me? Something drove them. Something inside them pushed them forward, saying, if you don't pull them out of that fire, who will? If you don't tell them about Christ, who will? If they die right now, will their blood be on your hands because you neglected to tell them about Christ? In the book of Ezekiel, the Bible states that if we don't tell the heathen that they're lost, their blood will be on our hands. But if we tell them, then their blood is on their hands. You know, we cannot make people serve Christ. We cannot make individuals push, give their all to Christ. The only thing we can do is tell them and point them to Christ. And if that's all